Hello, Year 9. This is our first video where we're annotating the poem Grade 1 Primary. Just like the slide said before this video, this poem does have a lot of vulgar language, language that we wouldn't endorse in our classrooms, and we definitely don't endorse them now. However, the way that the author is using that language to be authentic about her experiences, I think it's really important that we look at it. So I just wanted to make sure that everyone realizes that when we say these words within the poem and we describe that stanza and we look at, you know, the language techniques and all that stuff, that does not give you an okay to use those words in real life. Okay, now that disclaimer is out of the way, I once again have my steps to annotating a poem in front of me. My desk setup is exactly like last week, so if you don't remember, just go back to last week's PowerPoint. And just see how I have my desk set up, you know, how I'm ready to take notes and I'm ready to do the work, that I have an open, clear space. I know it can be a lot harder for you guys to find that kind of open, clear space, but it's really important, especially now that we are in an extended lockdown. We're not going to see you guys for at least another 3 weeks, that you have a dedicated study space. So, initial reading of the poem, and we're going to write down any questions that pop into our head while we're doing the initial reading. So let's start. Grade 1 Primary. I'm sitting up the tree today, and I'm not getting down. I don't feel safe at school no more, just 'cause my skin is brown. If I sit here overnight, will I turn into a bird? So I can fly away from here and all the nasty words. 'Cause it's no fun being different. Where do I fit in? Some kids at school are nasty, and their words just have a sting. Sorry, have such a sting. You half-caste dog, you coon, you boon. You stinkin' bloody abbo. I don't know what these words mean. I know they hurt me like an arrow. I asked my teacher to explain, and she just slapped me hard. And then when it was lunchtime, I was pushed over in the yard. So now I'm sitting up a tree. I'm hiding from everyone. I don't understand this place. I'm only in grade one. All right, so that is the poem. I really feel like it's one of her sadder poems that I've ever read. I've read a few of her poems, not just the ones that we're studying. I just feel that there's something very naive and small, like, you know, being so young. Like, she's a grade one child, so when you're in year one, like, how old are you? Like, 5, 6 years old, and she's going through all this bullying. It's just, breaks my heart. Okay, so we're first going to go through, like we did last time, and we're going to underline or highlight any of the words that we don't understand. So just like last time, we're going to go through each line, and I really feel like this language is very, very not common. It's very simplistic. It's not a complicated vocabulary that she's working with. I think it's to help with the voice of a child. Like, a child wouldn't say big words. They would just say little words. So I don't think there are many. These words here that I'm looking at, that I'm just going to, these ones, we will get to that later. I don't think there's any reason for people to be Googling what these words mean. Okay, we can tell just by context that they're terrible words that we don't use against people. So you don't need to look up the actual, I don't know, definition, I guess. Okay, so I feel like I understand all of the language in the poem. If there is any parts that you didn't understand, now is the time to pause this video and to go Google those words. Remember, I told you when we don't know something, we go straight to Google and we just define it, and then we put that definition into the sentence. And then reread the sentence with that new definition inside it to try and understand what the lines mean. So if you need to do that, now is the time to pause the video. Okay, welcome back. For anyone that had to pause the video, let's move on to point 3. Now, this is very different to the first poem we looked at, which I felt was a very open verse, free verse kind of poem. There wasn't really a rhyme or reason to it. This one is a way more structured poem, okay? Each stanza has 4 lines. It has a rhyme scheme in it. And so that's going to take time for us today to actually go through. So let's just have a look here. Now, a few of you might have forgotten how we actually work out our rhyming scheme. So first of all, we're going to write our stanzas. So if we just highlight, can we do a comment? Yes. Okay, and there's stanza one. And then we'll do a comment. Stanza two. And now remember, a stanza is just like a paragraph. But we don't say the word paragraph when we're looking at poetry. We say stanza. So if I'm asking you what's happening in stanza two, that means you're looking for the second section or the chunk. Stanza four. Stanza five. And the last one here. Stanza six. All right, so there are six stanzas in this poem, and we are going to find our rhyming scheme. Now, stanza one, this is our first chunk, and our rhyming scheme. So our rhyming scheme, each line will be given a letter, and if that rhyming scheme repeats, that's when that second letter will come in, like the duplicate letter. So let's just do the first stanza together. I'll try to show you what I mean by that. I'm sitting up the tree today, and I'm not getting down. So today and down do not rhyme. So this is A, this is B. I don't feel safe at school no more, just because my skin is brown. Okay, so what is the rhyming word there? Down and brown. Okay, so that means our B rhyming repeats, and that makes it a C. Does that make sense? So if there's no more rhyming, then we're just going to go C, D, E, F, G, H, all the way down. And if this down brown continues into the next one, they would also be B's. Okay, but we're just looking at stanza one. The first line doesn't rhyme with anything, and the third line doesn't rhyme with the first line. So today, more, definitely doesn't rhyme. So we're going to have to see that that's a different letter. And so because the rhyme scheme here, down and brown, do rhyme, that's when it becomes the B grouping. So let's have a look at this next one here. If I sit here overnight, will I turn into a bird? That's an A. Will I turn into a bird? That does not rhyme. So there we go, B. Oops. So I can fly away from here and all those nasty words. Now, words and bird don't have the same spelling, not the way down and brown does, but when you hear bird and word, you definitely hear that rhyming. So B, that's a C. Now, while I'm here, because the next part of this is to work out our number syllables. So I'm actually going to pause the video in a second and do this on my own so you guys don't have to listen to the whole thing. But while I'm doing that, I will also work out the syllables of the poem, and mark the number at the end of each line. So again, I'm just going to clap. I'm sitting up the tree today. Okay, so I'm sitting up the tree today. That's seven. And I'm not getting down. Six. I don't feel safe at school no more. That's eight. Sorry, I totally forgot what came after seven. Just because my skin is brown. Six. Now, I'm going to guess that these ones that are rhyming are going to be very similar all the way through. Let's just do the second stanza together and we'll just see if I'm correct in my guess. If I sit here overnight, that gives us seven. Will I turn into a bird? Seven. So I can fly away from here. That gives us eight. And all the nasty words. Ooh. Six. Will I turn into a bird? No, I'm sticking with my seven. But they're very close. It's very close. And none of these, and you can see here, except until we start getting down here, but we're going to talk about why that's different. Most of these stanzas seem to have a very solid rhyming pattern going on. So if you just want to pause the video here and do your own work, I'm going to pause the video myself and go do the work, and then I'll come back and I'll show you what I've done for the rhyming scheme and for our syllables. Okay, year nine, we are back now. As you can see, I've gone through and I have found the rhyming scheme and I've found the number of syllables in each line. We've already done the stanzas. So just to show you, and because I like color coding, all my rhyming schemes are in the same like sort of family, like that brown orange family, but if you look carefully, you can see that the B's are the same color and the A and the C are different. Just because I like that kind of thing. It's up to you how you do it. As long as it's clear where the rhyming schemes are, that's all that matters. The other thing we should be looking at is this rhyming scheme, not the rhyming scheme, is the syllables here and how many claps or bounces we have in each line. And this is what causes that rhythm when I'm reading it. It's pretty consistent throughout. So you can see here that nothing goes over eight. Even the longest line there doesn't go over eight. So she definitely has an idea of how she wants this to sound and how she wants it to be read. And that's pretty consistent throughout the whole thing. So moving on to our next one, we are going on to step five, where we are going to identify the figurative language used in the poem. Now, last week I went through each figurative language technique. I'm not going to do that this time because I really think it's good for us to sort of just realize where figurative language is. If you look at this and you're like, I can't find any figurative language, then that's when you'll need a list to move down. So let's have a look here. Excuse me. The first one I really noticed are these rhetorical questions. Now, there's a couple of rhetorical questions in here, I believe. Yeah, just up here, sorry. So the first one is, will I turn into a bird? And I'm going to highlight that in green. And my other rhetorical question here is, where do I fit in? And now I'm just going to label these. That's not, yeah, rhetorical question. Now, the reason why an author will use a rhetorical question is it gets the audience thinking, and when we're asked a question, we automatically want to respond. But without the audience, sorry, without the author there to actually interact one-on-one with the audience, it's near impossible for us to actually ask these questions, answer these questions for her, such as when she asks, will I turn into a bird? And we want to be like, no, you won't turn into a bird, but are you okay? Like, we may want to do follow-up questions. And that's why they put the rhetorical questions in there. It creates an intimacy between the author and the reader, and she's trying to bring us further into our into her world. So creates relationships between the author and reader. Okay, and the same one down here. Just going to do the same thing. Where are you? New comment. Now, if we have a look at these two rhetorical questions, one says, will I turn into a bird? And the other one says, where do I fit in? So they actually join together really nicely when you think about them like that. If she was asking these questions one after the other, like, you can feel that there is some feeling of overwhelmingness, or she doesn't like where she is. She's like, will I turn into a bird? Where do I fit in? I don't understand. All those kinds of words. So it's interesting to see where these come from. The next one we have here. Do, 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 do. I swear I read a simile. Can I fly away from here? This is a metaphor, so not what I was looking for, but maybe it was what I was thinking of. I should have written all, wrote all my notes down. So if I can fly away from here and all these nasty words, so we're just gonna put in, no, just gonna put here, and we're gonna write metaphor, and she's comparing. Comparing flying away. Okay, so she's comparing the idea, can I fly away from here, and all the nasty words. Flying away and birds. But there's no fun being different because the words have such a sting. There it is. They hurt me like an arrow. I knew there was a simile. So I'm just going to highlight that in green. And then we're going to add our comment. So it's a simile. The simile here is that she's comparing the words to the arrow. So compare words and arrows. Whoops, and arrows. Asked my teacher to explain and she just slapped me hard. Okay, slapped is onomatopoeia. So this poem is definitely a way more traditional poem in the sense of figurative language, stanzas, consistent rhythm and rhyme, like all those things you expect. When I say get a poem, oh, I spelt metaphor wrong, sorry. when I say get a poem, this is more what comes to mind when people think of poetry. And we'll talk about that in a second as soon as I remember how to spell onomatopoeia, which I'm pretty sure I did wrong. Please fix it. There we go. Onomatopoeia. Yeah, so I think the reason why she did this is because if we remember, this poem is called Grade 1 Primary. She is a child. She is 5, 6 years old. She's trying to understand what's going on in her world. She's the only Indigenous kid at her school. Everyone else is very, very white. So she stands out and she doesn't quite understand why, because she's too little to understand this whole idea of, you know, what it means to be adopted and those bigger questions she'll ask herself when she's older, like, you know, stolen generation questions and all that. Right now, she's just a kid that wants to fit in, doesn't have any friends, and is being really bullied because of the color of her skin. And so by keeping it in this really simple kind of language style and what we think a poem should be, we're reminded again of how young she is. This author's voice in this moment doesn't know all those cool tricks and stuff that she used last week when we were looking at circles and squares. Okay, there's not a lot of symbolism in this poem, and when there is, it's really basic symbolism. Okay, so if we go up here, and we got like the bird is a symbolism. And it is a symbolism. I'm just going to underline it. Okay. Bird as a symbolism is really basic. Most kids can tell you that birds are a symbolism of freedom. So it's not any of those big complicated sorts of symbols that she was using, like circles and squares, and what does it mean to be a square person and a circle person and trying to be both people but not being able to be fully either because her first years were taken when she was a child. Some kids at school are nasty. Their words have such a sting. Okay, again, onomatopoeia. What color was that? This gold color. So I think that when we're reading this, it's really important just to remember what sort of atmosphere is she trying to create. And I know that's a question we're going to ask ourselves later. I don't know what those words mean. Like an arrow pushed over in the yard. Only in grade one. Okay, I don't think does she say grade one anywhere else? No, it's just the. Okay, so no, not repetition. We do have this repetition of this first stanza with this stanza down here, where this stanza starts with, I'm sitting up the tree today. And then this one here is, so now I'm sitting up the tree. I'll hide from everyone and I'm not getting down. Okay, I don't understand this place. I don't feel safe at school no more. I'm only in grade one just because just because my skin is brown. So there's definitely some repetition going on here. So I'm just going to use my draw tool and circle and here. Okay, so why do you think she's repeating it at the beginning and the end? I'm just going to connect them. Connecting, connecting, connecting. So I'm just going to connect them. Okay, so why do you think she's repeating the first line of the first stanza and the first line on this last stanza? Okay, it's sort of giving us this idea that she does this a lot. Okay, it opens up with, I'm sitting up the tree today. And it sort of has that vibe of she does this a lot. She's probably found up this tree by the teachers often enough that when she says, I'm sitting up the tree today, she doesn't need to tell us what tree it is. She doesn't need to explain why she's up the tree. It's all told later in the poem. And so now I'm sitting up the tree. And we know that we now know why she's in the tree and that she's probably going to do this again. It's safe to assume if this poem was going to continue, the tree would again start to crop up again, maybe as a stronger motif. I think that's all we have for for figurative language. If you found some more, come and let me know. Just put it in the chat or let your teachers know, because I'm definitely open to having a discussion. I think this is why doing this online learning thing is really tricky, because I don't have anyone to bounce off here and to be like, oh, this is cool, this is not cool, what's happening here, and all that kind of stuff. Oh, that's what I wanted to talk about, this one. Okay, so this here is all imagery. So we're going to highlight that. And do we have green yet? Yes, we do. There we go, we don't have that color yet. Okay, so this is imagery. And what she's doing here is, when she says this part, she's trying to make, not trying to make you feel bad for her, she's trying to put you into a moment with her. Imagery. Yeah, go me. She's trying to bring you into this moment with her, that these are words, that's like if in the middle of a poem we're talking about, like, I've been bullied at school, nobody likes me, I wish I could just leave, why can't I just fly away from all these nasty people, I hate school, and then, she, you know, and then I said, you know, a whole bunch of derogatory words, like, you know, I dropped the C-bomb, and I say the F-word, and that kind of stuff, and I just, like, for two sentences, like, that's quite a bit considering there's only six stanzas. So for two whole sentences, she just piles on these terrible words that people would call Indigenous people, which isn't fair and it isn't right. And so she wants you to feel this moment with her, this image of a six-year-old, five-year-old girl being bullied by her school, and just nobody cares. Okay, and just to bring that on even further, we have this one here. I asked my teacher to explain. So this is, again, some imagery. Whoops. Gotta make sure we highlight it before we do a comment. So she's just been bullied in the playground. And she doesn't know what these words mean. She's like, I don't know what these words mean. I just know that they hurt when I hear them. And then she asks her teacher, she's like, why do people, what do these words mean? Like, why are they calling me these things? And then the teacher slapped her. And when it was lunchtime, I was pushed over in the yard. Okay, all up here we have a lot of, like, you know, the words. Words are getting to her. People are verbally being rude to her. Okay, their words have such a sting. And then after that, it's actually getting physical. Her teacher slaps her, and then kids in the playground push her over. Okay, so the abuse that she's getting as an Indigenous child in this school is just growing, and she doesn't have anyone to turn to. Her teachers are against her. The kids are against her. She really does feel all alone. So it's really important that we have a look at how she uses imagery to really draw us in. And I think, push me over in the yard. Oh, here we go. I'll hide from everyone. Okay, so this is an example of hyperbole. Oh, we're running out of colors. Do we have the red yet? No. Okay, so this is hyperbole here. Okay, I'll hide from everyone. Look, literally, she can't hide from everyone. That's silly. Whoops. But she wants to hide from everyone, and that's the important thing there. So we're just going to put in hyperbole. And this is something that, like, a lot of little kids do. They're like, I hate you, I hate everyone. That kind of, like, inclusive of everybody sucks kind of mentality, when really it's not everyone. She feels like it, and she feels like she wants to hide from everyone, but it might not be literally everyone. Okay, so if you have any more examples, please put them up in your group chats. Your teachers will get them onto me, and I would love to hear what you guys think. This first part of looking at grade one primary and breaking it down a little bit into its little pieces. I could go on and on and on about this poem, but I really feel that you're going to get bored just listening to my voice. So this is where we're going to stop for now, and then the next video will be coming. All right, guys, I'll see you then. Bye.